Welcome, everybody, to our first assembly event, Who Has Agency and Whose Voices Are Heard? It's fantastic to see so many of you here. There's over 200 people in the room, so thank you so much for coming. Assembly is a series of four online learning and development events for curators, producers, and public art practitioners that explore issues and good practice in relation to the expanded field of public art. The programme invites you, the public art community, to explore the role public art can play in raising awareness and effecting change on issues around diversity, community cohesion, and the digital realm as a public space. Its aim is to encourage collective knowledge sharing and peer-to-peer learning, and across the four events, we've put together a fantastic group of socially engaged curators, artists, and practitioners who will explore questions around who has agency, what is collaboration, what is the role of curators in socially engaged practice, and is the future of public art online? If you haven't already done so, please do sign up for the other events in the series that will be taking place monthly across April, May and June. All details can be found on UpProject's website. And the speakers at each event will also be invited to contribute a case study, and we'll be publishing the case studies as a downloadable resource on our website, and we'll also share them by email to everyone who's attended the event. So do look out for those in a few weeks' time. This programme has come about through a collaboration between UpProjects and the Public Art Network, and it's generously supported by the Art Fund. And I'm really delighted that this partnership has come to fruition. Both organisations have identified that there are very little opportunities for public art curators and practitioners, particularly those working in the field of socially engaged practice. So often we're thrown in at the deep end and expected to learn on the job, performing the many different roles required to develop and deliver this complex work with very little support or guidance. Creating opportunities for knowledge sharing and safe spaces to explore ideas around ethics and best practice, or simply just to ask questions, seems vital as the sector moves forward through and out of COVID in order to continue to positively contribute to the communities and the public context that we operate in. For UpProjects, Assembly is a fantastic addition to our programme, sitting alongside Constellations, our learning and development programme for artists who have an interest in community-oriented practice. As a public art organisation that's committed to supporting artists to make new work that has social relevance, engages communities and encourages learning, we're really excited to be able to help shape and facilitate this programme, as well as support the emerging Public Art Network to further develop as a sector specialist network that focuses on professional development, as well as external advocacy, making connections to artists, commissioners and the public. So today's event is exploring who has agency and whose voices are heard. Diversity, access and inclusion have become buzzwords in the field of public art, but it remains stubbornly undiverse and alien to many. And how can we change this to ensure that the work we produce is inclusive and relevant to a diverse public? To help us unpick all of this, I'm delighted to introduce Amanprit Sandhu, our chair for today's discussion. Amanprit is a curator and educator with a focus on commissioning performance-based practices and collaborative approaches to working. Her current work includes organising the inaugural biannual programme for the Borough of Brent in London and co-curating the 2021 Borås Art Biennial in Sweden. She was the co-founder of the curatorial collective DAM Projects and has worked as curator at Wising Art Centre, Art on the Underground and Camden Art Centre. She is a curatorial practice tutor at the Curating Contemporary Art MA at the Royal College of Art and visiting lecturer at Chelsea College of Arts. So we are in very safe hands here. Amanprit will also be joined by two fantastic speakers, Linda Rocco, London-based curator, and Roseanna Dias, who's a curator based in Bristol. So without further ado, I'm really delighted to hand over to Amanprit to introduce the speakers in more detail. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Emma. That was a lovely introduction. And a big hello to everyone. It was really nice seeing everyone introduce themselves. So I've just made a note here. We've got people here from Hastings, Glasgow, Newcastle, Krakow, Madrid, and also Toronto. So that's really exciting to just know that there's a big sort of audience who want to have these conversations. So I'm just going to talk a bit about the format of today and then introduce our speakers, Linda Rocco and Roseanna Dias. So Linda and Roseanna will be talking for 10 minutes each. I'm going to introduce them through their bios, and there will be no break. So Linda will talk for 10 minutes, and that will be followed by Roseanna presenting a short film, Under My Skin. And Roseanna will then go into her 10-minute presentation. And that will then be followed by a conversation, which will be approximately half an hour. And it is important that you feel like you can contribute to the conversation in a very live way. So there's a prompt that you've seen already. So we've had the question in one word, what does diversity mean to you? And it's great to see sort of the responses we've got back already. So inclusivity, inclusion, everyone, equity are the ones that are, kind of sort of shouting out to me, but there will be another prompt. So please do keep, as kind of ideas or thoughts come to your mind, do add to the Q&A, and I can then field those questions to Linda and Roseanna. And now more to the kind of formal part of what I need to introduce. So it is the first event, and the idea behind this event was to explore issues and raise questions about diversity, acknowledging the idea that the lack of diversity among audiences and within artistic leadership are two interlinked issues. So the presentation by our two speakers will illustrate how two different projects have addressed the need to diversify audiences. And the speakers won't be merely describing the projects, but will rather describe the issues at stake. And then to introduce Linda and her work, Linda Rocco is a London-based contemporary art curator and a PhD candidate at the Royal College of Art, funded by the AHRC. She's a creative consultant for Liberty at the Greater London Authority, the GLA, and has curated public events and exhibitions internationally with established small-scale institutions as Delfina Foundation to warehouse spaces such as Yinka Shonabar's studio guest projects, including the curation of the public sphere for Nine Elms on the South Bank. Linda co-directs the non-for-profit organisation Inventory Platform, which engages communities in urban and rural contexts through socially engaged projects since 2016. She also co-directs the Disability Arts Festival and engagement programme, I'm Here, Where Are You?, produced with Cambridge Junction. Linda regularly works as a curator for artists and private galleries, as well as consulting for charities, foundations and public institutions on accessible and socially engaged arts collaboration with STEM subjects, as well as participatory and intermediate practices. And recent collaborations include the Gove Institute London, Danish Arts Foundation, Ministry of Culture Taiwan, Pineapple Lab Philippines, Frieze Art Fair London, and the Laura Gennold Gallery London, to name a few. Welcome, Linda. And I'm also going to introduce Roseanna at this point as well. Roseanna Dias is a Bristol-based producer, curator and facilitator interested in creativity and social change. Her focus is on supporting young creatives, in particular through film, media and digital projects. Her work draws on co-creation, action research and approaches which centre care. And today she's going to speak about her work at Rising Arts Agency, which is a youth-led creative agency supporting artists aged 18 to 30, where she is currently executive producer for Be It, a radical leadership programme, and critical researcher for Resourcing Racial Justice. And at this point, I'd like to hand over to Linda.
Thank you, Amanprit. Thank you so much. I hope you can hear me and see me. So my name is Linda Rocco, pronounced she, her, and I'm a white woman with a bright yellow jacket and some long hair. So I'm here to present where I'm coming from. Where I'm coming from was a month-long digital program commissioned by the Yinka Shonibare Foundation in partnership with multiple stakeholders, which you can see on the slide. And the program was curated by Inventory Platform, which is a non-for-profit organization that I co-direct with artist Ryan Bernardino. And it was originally conceived to happen in a real space at guest projects in London in Broadway Market, but had to move to the digital realm due to the pandemic. Since then, I've curated a few other projects online, but where I'm coming from was the first experiment, let's say. So the month-long program was dedicated to four languages that are very much present and spoken by a big portion of the migrant community, actively working and contributing to the British economy, yet highly invisible: Filipino, Berber languages, Taiwanese, and Yoruba. The program aimed to tackle the exclusivity of language in accessing the production and consumption of arts and culture, alongside considering the wider cultural presence of underrepresented artists and groups in the international art debate. Next slide, please. The program showcased three artists each week, allocating 2 days to each artist. The aim was to utilize only one specific language per week. The text used to mediate each work were in this case in Filipino, and the English translation would follow the original language in a sort of subordinate position. We really wanted to highlight the kind of importance of language and its potential for communal organization, but also how it serves as a ground for separation. And we did so by generating an environment which was hard to access for the English-speaking audience, who, in order to know more, had to engage, sort of complicating the user experience. So you see here, for example, an image of Genophobia, which was a live performance hypnosis taking place over Zoom. And we negotiated with the artist Lili Befquenka Rasmussen a way in which to integrate the sort of translation in real time in Tagalog. So we provided an artist that was sort of working with Libef in order to coordinate, and it proved to be really a fruitful and really interesting collaboration. Next slide, please. The projects oriented towards increasing opportunities for new ways of working collaboratively, rethinking the arts impact in a pandemic scenario. At the end of each week, we also programmed cooking sessions to allow the general audience to learn about each cultural group's cuisine, to possibly reproduce and engage in their own homes. For the cooking sessions, we engaged various community groups, and it was really fascinating to see how the groups interpreted the brief in very different ways and format. In the Filipino week, for example, we had a group of UK-based migrant workers who produced a talk show-like format wherein they were cooking a national dish called adobo and discussing at the same time Filipino culture in a very sort of engaging and humorous way. Next slide, please. The variety of works showcased encompasses live performance, video works, GIF, animation, text-based and image works. And we wanted to keep working with the artists that we originally selected for the In Real Life program, who weren't necessarily digital artists or kind of acquainted to work in that space. Therefore, we had to work really closely with each of them to discuss the best adaptation of the work into the digital realm and support them in this sort of transition. The initial artist selection came from multiple processes, including lots of research, our wish to engage with certain artists, as well as deepening the partnership we had, for example, with the Inka Shonibare Foundation, who has a corresponding foundation launching in Nigeria, in Lagos. And so it was for us important to sort of generate this dialogue and connect with the resources we had available. Next slide, please. The program emphasized the importance of highlighting diversity and multiculturalism in such unique times, considering strategies for working together and supporting each other, despite living in very different contexts. We were extremely careful in focusing on the mediation of each work. We produced captions for each video. We were very sort of straight in this, because the mediation was really important, being all about language. We had a huge budget for translation. We had audio files and easy read guide for the program. In doing so, we offered various entry points into the work for a whole set of diverse audiences. For this cooking session, for example, you see a group of Moroccan cooks preparing this wonderful octopus tagine on a beach in Morocco, and it was really poetic. Next slide, please. The aim of the program was to highlight the several micro-narratives of exclusion that exist within those who face cultural and language barriers, wanting to offer visibility to really meaningful body of work. Our target audience was obviously the sort of UK arts community, but also those who don't necessarily engage with the arts, but they do understand the language. We also had media partners in the respective countries to sort of enhance the works distribution beyond the UK. Next slide, please. The program itself was spread across the main guest project's website. We also had a weekly newsletter and daily social media posts. The month was coordinated and choreographed to offer great visibility to the artist's work across platforms, presenting both old works when they were relevant, obviously, to the topic, but also new commission. And some works were there for the audience to experience any times. Others were premiering at specific time and day. So we were, again, playing with the temporality of the space. Next slide, please. Such complex and modular program definitely had its risks, especially because we're not a big institution and there wasn't obviously much tech support available, especially considering the distance and all the hiccups that can occur when depending on the internet connection. In this regard, it was essential for us to perform duties of care and really double checking with the artists, making sure to establish great communication with all the parties involved in order to maximize the artist's work and the program. In the Yoruba week, for example, we had an hour and a half long live performance from Lagos. And we had really to make sure to rehearse this in advance and discuss with the artists the pros and cons of being live versus offering a pre-recorded format. And so really negotiate and discuss the artistic choice and the modalities of engagement coming from such choice. So it was really much a process of negotiation to adapt to the digital space. Where I'm coming from, which happened in August, was the first iteration, a test bed, which will be helpful to devise future iteration of the program. And as the program began, we were immediately faced with the existing limits of digital communication. We noticed that disjointed phenomenon, sorry, next slide, please. A disjointed phenomenon regarding how certain posts on social media were highly appreciated, yet the amount of views of the actual work was reduced. So we promptly realized how in certain countries, social media are accessible and free part of a plan, whereas navigating on the internet becomes a paid service. Therefore, again, the social media impression were really a synonym of full engagement. So again, questioning what is really kind of online digital real engagement. Next slide, please. This is an example of how the program was spread to maximize the audiences and tap into the diverse communities. So you see the mail out and the various kind of social media. It was important to us to reflect from the shift from an in real life space to the digital one, what has been lost during this shift. Considering especially that up to 2019, 57% of the global population were internet users, and English account for 60% of all online content. So it was really pivotal for us to consider that that has been lost in the shift and the digital sort of physical interaction that was lost in the process, particularly when envisioning future iteration of the project, both offline and online. And then next slide, please. These are some final stats where you can see the social media engagement and that discrepancy I was mentioning. You know, hopefully we really weren't focusing on kind of make advertisement on social media, but really about the work. So I was interested to explore this discrepancy. And I want to just leave as final consideration the archival potential of the projects and the values generated by the artist's works in highlighting the mother tongue and the variety of dialects almost disappearing, that whereas exist within where I'm coming from itself. as well as the sort of discourse of the permanent dimension of the online space compared to the more temporary one of the kind of exhibition format. So yeah, this is it from me, and thank you all for listening.
I stop myself from crying by laughing, smiling, pretending. Distraction, screens, words, sounds. Anything to transport me. I fight for the off switch. Shutting down the machine that I am. I can't stop myself from crying.
Okay. Thanks, Linda, for that really great presentation. As Amanrit said, I am Roseanna Dias. I'm a producer from Bristol. My pronouns are she, her. I'm a mixed South Asian, white, British, cis woman. I'm aged 31, got long dark hair, wearing an orange shirt, and I'm sitting in a green room. So the clip you've just seen is one of the three film pieces which make up the case study I'm going to speak to you about today, called Under My Skin. And when the presentation comes up, you will see a photo taken, here we are, of some of the crew in the golden hour outside, taken outside Integrate's offices where we filmed. Can I have the next slide, please, Lily? So a little bit about Rising. Rising is based in Bristol, and we support young people aged 18 to 30 to challenge inequalities in the creative sector. Our work is youth-led and is about making visible those who are currently underrepresented in the sector. And the work really manifests itself in a variety of ways through showcasing young artists' work, both on our website and on the streets, through bringing in other high profile commissions to both challenge the status quo and provide employment to young people. We champion authentic voices and lived experiences. And we also recognize that this conversation often needs to go beyond the boundaries of our close community. And our work with the Co-Creating Change cohort in particular is supporting us to reach new communities in mindful and meaningful ways. We create pathways and support for young people to be leaders in the sector and input into strategic conversations, including sitting on boards. So Rising really works at this intersection of community and the creative sector. And we're constantly learning and evolving as part of a small team pictured here and a much wider crew of young creatives and activists. The next slide, please. So onto the case study. Under My Skin was a project that we realised back in autumn 2019, which feels like years and years ago now. It was created in response to The Destructors, a film by Imran Peretta, which was screening at Spike Island in Bristol. So 11 young people of colour and of mixed heritage were invited to take part in conversations and workshops exploring the themes of identity and marginalisation present in the exhibition. And across two workshops, we explored personal testimonies, developed film, photographic and audio skills, and we created this series of short films. Under My Skin is a triptych that focuses particularly on the identity of young women as a counterpoint to Imran's film. And it explores ideas of vulnerability and self-love
creating really intimate portraits of personal experiences through spoken word and visual poetry. And the film we created then screened alongside Imran's in the gallery. And on opening night, we invited other members of our community to perform. And together we enjoyed their offerings of dance, spoken word, and we discussed the work and what it means to do this kind of work. This was a Spike Island commission, and it was delivered in partnership with Integrate, a youth-led charity that empowers young people to take an active role in transforming the society they live in. It's interesting that Integrate, this key partner in the project, is often not mentioned, and perhaps because they sit outside of the creative sector, and yet the lived experience that those young people from Integrate brought to this project was invaluable. It relates to our firm belief at Rising in this kind of ever-expanding notion of what creativity is. We engage not just with artists, but also incredible creative and critical thinkers. And Under My Skin was really an interesting opportunity to bring together artists from our community with activists from Integrate and learn from one another. We're asked to do a lot of collaborations and partnerships, and it feels like with this project, it wasn't to do so much with the prestige of Spike Island as it was to do with the phenomenal power and poetics of Imran's work that attracted us to say a big yes. The fact that Imran wanted to be involved, to be present at our first workshop and our evening event, to meet our crew, it was a massive draw. So speaking to one of the artists contributors to the project recently, they spoke specifically to this collapsing of the artist-participant divide, saying that it was quite an unusual and empowering thing to be creating and performing in proximity to Imran. And I think that, you know, in Rising, our DNA is kind of, we're thinking constantly about how we are nurturing community and connection and flattening some of the hierarchies that we come across. My next slide, please, Lily. So the first thing to note is that we didn't come into this project with preconceptions about what the outcome would be. We workshopped this with participants, and Imran and Spike were really happy to take a back seat and to be led where we needed to go according to our young people. And we knew we could show something in the gallery if we wanted to. We knew we could have a kind of convening event, but essentially it was an open brief. And our parameters were really the budget and the time that Sham Ahmed, my co-producer on this, who also worked at Integrate, they were kind of the parameters in which we had to deliver this. And so we focused on the skills that we each had and the desires of the people who came along. And from the beginning, it was the process that was valued as much, if not more, than the product. And I think that's not always the case. So we knew we wanted to hold space for people in our communities to get film and meet him, start with conversation and move into some creative activities that would enable us to bring our reflections, our stories, personalities into the process. And as workshop leaders, we created the framework to collectively write the poetry that you see in the films. People really gifted their ideas to this process, and then we all together pulled it into three distinct film ideas with overarching themes. And we did this in person, but also remotely when this wasn't even a thing, with people who couldn't physically make the second workshop. They were co-editing the scripts and the storyboards on Google Docs from their beds. We all made it what it needed to be. And similarly with the event, we put a shout out for members of our community to come forward, and then we offered them a fee for their input. For me, this project was a pivotal moment in my practice as a creative producer and curator, and it proved to me that the best co-creation happens when you feel this sense of expansiveness that can also feel a bit scary, like things haven't settled yet, and it requires just the most gentlest of holding for the good stuff to emerge. And I was speaking with our director, Kamina Walton, last week. She'd been on a recent Zoom gathering where Carrie Robinson, who's the head of learning at South London Gallery, said, if you feel you're losing control, you're probably co-designing, and this is a positive space to be in. And like, that really sums up that process and that feeling for me. Next slide, please. And I think it's really important to say that Under My Skin was only possible because of the relationships we've developed with our communities through longer term projects, such as Whose Culture, which nurtured conversation and community, both online and offline, for young creatives of color, and which saw our demographic shift from 40 to 60% POC see over the course of 2 years. And along the bottom of this slide, you see 10 young creatives, some of whom have been involved in Whose Culture and Under My Skin. They are now part of Be It, our radical leadership program, which again has been co-created from the very beginning and continues to shift depending on our community needs. So this work exists as part of a continuum that's built on trust with communities that are already embedded within Rising. And what Spike understood and recognized in this commission was that Rising and Integrate have already developed these deep relationships and ways of working over time. And so they trusted us to hold the commission as we felt we needed to. And I think that is fundamental. It's not about parachuting in. Spike didn't insist that their team did this work. They understood that to do this work, they had to pay us as organizations to figure out in step with our communities what it would look like and then find a process to bring Imran into that and using Spike as a conduit. So instead of working to the idea of young people bringing their ideas into the institution here became a resourced holding space for critical collaborations to happen, which were led by what we as a group felt should happen. And the sense of agency, ownership, and joy that this creates cannot be underestimated. Under My Skin wouldn't have had the value or the poignancy for the young people and the audiences if it hadn't been for the way all the other work had happened before. And it isn't exactly replicable, but hopefully in sharing the story of Under My Skin, some of the principles at its heart can be practiced, developed by others when thinking about socially engaged public art projects that involve people who are othered by the sector and society. And just the final slide has our website address on rising.org.uk. You can go there to check out more of our work, and just thank you for listening. And I'm looking forward to the discussion. Thanks.
Thanks so much, Roseanna and Linda. I'm just going to give Lily a prompt to put up the second question for our attendees. And I guess I want to start, there are some questions which I'll come to, but there are things from both your presentations that really spoke to me. I really like this idea of losing control, because actually that's, I know sort of all, not all of us, some of us will feel this, that's quite a scary place to be as a curator or producer, but I really kind of love that as an idea. And co-designing, negotiation, Linda, you spoke about. And I guess my first question is, you pointed towards it in both of your presentations. This is a broad question, but it's really broad so that you can come at it from your own experience. But I wondered, in both your cases, what are the strategies that support participants to have agency and platform their voices? What for you are those strategies, and where in your own projects or elsewhere have you seen that working the best? I hope that's not too broad a question, but Linda, perhaps if we start with you.
Sure. Thanks, Amanprit. And thanks, Roseanna, for the great presentation. Well, I guess in terms of strategy, really, it's about, as I said, losing controls entails as well having a certain degree of trust and really be able to sort of move away from a position of somehow, you know, directing from above in a sort of master puppet dimension, but really being able to give the space and the conditions for the artists in this case to work kind of freely and process kind of ideas in a flexible yet supported way as well, you know, being there, being available to discuss works, to discuss sort of questions, to rehearse, to really have that conversation and follow the process from early conception to then what is the delivery, sort of. In a process of negotiation, yes, which is very much about listening as well, more than maybe talking. Yeah, I think that's my...
Thanks, Linda.
Yeah, thanks, Linda. I was nodding furiously, like nodding away. That all really resonates. I think you spoke about listening, and I just think it's something that we don't practice enough just in general, but In terms of what we kind of get trained to do, like reading, we get 12 years of reading training, and we actually communicate with it something like 9% of the time, whereas listening, we kind of get no training in it really, and we use it 45% of the time. So it's like there's a real lack of being able to listen and actively listen. And I think just as a basis for how you work with people in new ways, it's like just listen, just really hone that listening skill, that active listening skill. And when you're listening, don't feel you have to come up with all the answers. You can just being witness and listening is a really important thing. And I think sometimes I know for myself as like a producer type person, I want to like help fix and solve and all of that. But actually allowing people, trusting people to have the answers, the way forward themselves, and being a kind of holding space for them to express that feels really important. And I just think it's not really part of our culture. And at Rising, we've done a lot of training around coaching and how you hold coaching space. And a huge part of that is active listening. So I think, yeah, it's a huge important strategy that just doesn't get enough airtime.
Yeah, I mean, what you've said about active listening akin to deep listening really does resonate, which then leads me to another broad question, but one I think both of you are in a really good position to speak to, which is then what are the formats that exist right now in our kind of organisations or in the sector that aren't working, that aren't allowing us to do that active type of listening, allowing us to lose control, or, you know, we're in fear of that, you know, is it something to do with time? Is it the structures and the formats that need to shift? Is it, yeah, just a prompt and a provocation?
Thanks, Amanprit. That would take a long answer, but to be sort of short, I would say that, well, there's lots of things that don't really work right now. And I think we are prone to work in a way which really fits into neoliberal capitalist narrative of, as well, producing in sort of post-Fordist imperative. So again, very much linked to producing objects and evaluating, following very much kind of metrics and ticking boxes. So I think really the way in which we understand that, the way in which as well institutions deal with the work we do could be and should be much more flexible. We are often as well kind of brought in the discussion in very short terms. And it's very rare to kind of generate that long-term environment of learning and sharing. So I think we very much work on this kind of short-termism, having to, again, depending on funding structures, which are often kind of shady and requires lots of back work and then sort of bureaucracy, which sometimes really benchmark the value of all that we do into some sort of siloed categories. So I think there's many problems in the so-called art world and the way in which things are done right now. But hopefully as well, the pandemic and this whole shift to more kind of digital formats will be helpful in opening a bit more our eyes and as well welcoming other cooperative forms of participation where the sort of tasks and duties are much more shared rather than being centralized in the head of you.
And Roseanna, is there anything from your experience that you want to add to that?
Yeah, I think everything that Linda spoke about really rings true. And I think, I mean, just kind of going back to the kind of provocation of for this event around the buzzwords and the co-option really of lots of words and terms that you see in the sector. I mean, I guess I was speaking to a producer friend called Angie Buell, who runs Trigger, and they described a lot of what they saw last year around the Black Lives Matter uprisings following the murder of George Floyd, that it was this, it became very, very evident in a kind of like super turned up to max volume way that the issues that were affecting people of color in the industry were very much seen, but not necessarily felt by many. And I think that feeds into this kind of, there's a lot of talk of inclusion, there's a lot of talk about diversity, but actually people are not practiced in the walk. And when there are opportunities for diverse work to be created, it's often pigeonholing people into making work specifically about their identity or their story. And sometimes that's wanted and desired. And other times they just want to make work about, like, you know, something completely unrelated in a sense. And I kind of, you know, picking up on what Linda was saying, there is often not that flexibility and that space for flexing and moving in step, that it's just not practiced and not seen to be valued, because it's very, can be very extractivist and very kind of, everything's sort of a means to an end. So I'm really interested in production processes, curatorial processes, which totally like flip that around and don't start with an outcome, but focus a lot more on the process.
Yeah, I think there's again something around sort of value, which is again a really kind of more longer conversation that feels kind of important to drill down on as a sector as well. I'm now going to open up a bit more, taking in sort of questions from the attendees. But one of the things that I did want to do as a chair of this event was acknowledge questions that, and I hope it's okay to, we've received questions about the accessibility of the event, which is an important one. And I'll speak just from my personal point of view in response to that. It is a blind spot for the event. And I know Emma will speak to that question directly. And it will, you know, it was also mentioned that we again talk about these buzzwords and then how is that enacted, you know, in an event like that, in an event like this, where we haven't sort of provided captions and other things. And I guess what I would like to say is this is not a cop-out answer, but, you know, the kind of problem is systemic and it's behavioural in the way that we kind of do things as professionals, and it takes time to, you know, undo that. And I can talk from, you know, hearing both you and Roseanna and Linda just describe sort of where you were and what you were wearing. I'm still learning about that personally. You know, so I've been kind of professionalized and socialized in a particular way in the art world, which means, of course, there are huge omissions, and there's also omissions when we ask this question, who has agency, whose voices are heard, but also the audiences we're addressing with that, when we haven't thought about access completely in the event. It's a blind spot, and I think it's important to acknowledge that. But what I would say is I'm sure Up Projects will respond to this and incorporate it into future events. But thank you so much for pointing that out, because it's important to do so. So one of the things that we asked as our second question was, has your understanding of diversity changed over the past year? And the response we've got is 78% of attendees have said yes, it has, and 23 have said no. And again, like Linda and Roseanna, I just wanted to ask, from your experience over the past year, what's shifted for you both personally and as professionals in the sector when you think about these terms and the parameters of diversity? Is it a kind of word that we need to be using anymore? You know, who does it serve?
Thanks, Amanprit. Well, I think, as we already said, diversity as a term has been quite of a buzzword over the past year. But there's definitely some interesting and important conversation going on issues specifically regarding race and gender. in our sector, I believe there's still much work to be done, especially from kind of contemporary arts should diversify more and really actively looking for less elitist approaches to make art, to distribute and present art. I was myself shielding for this past year. So really think we should be, again, I don't want to go back to the flexible term, but we should really be much more welcoming of diversity, because it's ultimately diversity which makes the exciting variety and brings that new, original, fresh ideas, because otherwise we really risk to fall into those dynamics and narratives that are a bit stagnant and that we're already very acquainted with. So I think diversity is needed to really bring those discourses that are important, feel relevant and feel timely in a time where there's been a global pandemic.
Thanks, Linda.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, Linda. And I think a lot of our work, you know, I described Rising as kind of sitting between the community and the sector. And I think this year, we have definitely observed the significance of young people from diverse backgrounds being a part of strategic level conversations and change, particularly around the kind of social and political shifts that we've seen in the last year, and particularly around the sort of it feels like there's been a big shift and a lot of people in those kind of around those boards tables or in the exec kind of teams of arts organizations are dealing with an unprecedented level of like uncertainty. And there is actually a real opportunity here to kind of open up that space for other people who essentially they actually do need to involve for their sustainability, for their relevance, and for a lot of these questions that it feels keep coming up time and time again around how do we get more diverse audiences to see this work, etc., etc. You know, part of it is that grassroots stuff, but it's also about impacting where the decisions are being made. And we have a program where we recruit and train and support young people into governance roles, and it's very difficult without a program like that for us to infiltrate at strategic level, and particularly in terms of paid roles, because there's a ladder you have to climb. But actually in terms of boards, it's really interesting because it's not a paid role. And actually in the wake of the BLM uprisings, people want that diversity of voice. And you know, these young people don't have a CV as long as you're on, but they have experiences and new ways of thinking that will be absolutely invaluable for the sector to survive and thrive in the future. Yeah.
Linda,
go ahead.
Mind if I just add a point, because Roseanna, I think, was very timely brought up the kind of audience diversity in this sense, and I would just feel relevant to add that I think it's not enough nowadays to just say that, you know, oh yeah, this program is open to everyone, you know, everyone is welcome, everyone can come, but it's actually important to as well highlighting how this is welcoming for specific audiences. So for instance, I had a quick gaze at the chat and there's discourses on kind of engaging with artists who are mother or have kind of parenting role. And it's as well important that while advertising certain opportunities, let's say, ways in which you can really support mothers or certain people with specific access needs should really be visible in the call, in the invitation of the event, rather than advertising sort of an event open to all or a call for everybody, really trying as well to reach out to those communities if you really want to engage them and make sure the message gets to them, and as well you kind of accommodate everything, things to make sure that the process is as well suitable and for those specific constituencies. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Kirsten's comment is in the chat, and I think that idea of the creative environment needs to include all generations, all sort of generations of art practitioners is a very sort of important one. I'm looking at the questions we have, and one of the questions, which Roseanna is connected to the project you worked on, I'm just going to read it to you so you can respond. It was nice seeing that insight into Imran Peretta's The Distractors and the way this project came out of that. A new texture of the work being connected. It is an opposite to my initial engagement with the work, which was seen at the Chisenhill Gallery, in a cold art gallery, very detached from wider communities, and of the experiences that make the work. It makes me think, does all art practice have to have a connection to being in cold art spaces, detached from community, despite whatever projects, programs come out of it? So I think this is a broader question, you know, about sort of how artists see sort of their work being presented. There was, of course, choices sort of there about where this film was going to be presented. But I wonder if both of you could speak to that, more about that sort of conversation around, you know, where sort of art takes place, where process takes place, and then does it then have to be presented back in sort of the white cube? And also connected to that question, you know, is that question even relevant? You know, it would just be good to get your opinions in response to that note.
Do you want to go, Roseanne?
Sure, thanks. A really great comment and question. In terms of like where the art takes place and whether it has to be in the white cube or, you know, an institution, I guess the point is that institutions, organizations, people with buildings, whilst they have become a difficult space to manage during COVID, they hold a lot of the resources that are kind of that support the work getting made, that house the work. And I think it's really important to note that, you know, they're publicly funded institutions that are there to promote and support and showcase work. So there's definitely a purpose there. But, you know, I would just say as well that, you know, my experience and thinking a lot over the last year, you know, we're making our own spaces, to be honest. We're taking over the streets and putting our stuff there. So we exist as part of an ecosystem, and the institutions are really important, really important. But I would also say, you know, we need to remember that not everything necessarily doesn't need to be seen as the final place. Like, maybe it's a stepping stone, maybe it's a conduit. You know, we talked about Spike as being a conduit. So how can it be a conduit for the talent, for the energy, without kind of trying to contain it, which is essentially a kind of, yeah, a neoliberal capitalist kind of mentality. So I'm interested in how you can shift to being a conduit.
And also that's interesting because you have spoken about working with community and third sector, well, you didn't say third sector organisations, but the work also lends itself, or that sort of way of working lends itself to sort of working with other types of agencies and organisations. I'm just going to go to some other questions that we got. So Ruth Gard has said, speaking to Roseanna's points around the lack of true and concrete action around diversity in the cultural sector after George Floyd's murder, if there are any freelancers here who feel strongly about anti-racist action, then I would love to hear from you. Okay, so that's in the chat, and it's really important that it's nice to see this kind of event sort of also being a connector, so people coming together. So that wasn't so much a question. Just seeing what else, because I've got lots of more questions, but it's important to see what comments we have. Okay, so Dan Goodman has said, rather than a patchwork of inclusivity dealing with the challenges of individual groups, there is also the problem that inclusivity still centres white, cis and able-bodied people. I think we should be working towards a language of flexibility that accounts for all groups as well as the intertextuality of people's identity and experience. Well, I absolutely agree with that. And if I could comment on that a bit, Dan, what I'd say is that historically arts organisations in the arts, contemporary art field, has sometimes found it hard to maybe hold those complexities, but things are shifting. Roseanna, I just want to kind of riff off one of the things you said, which is people are creating their own spaces and having their own conversations. And that's one of the things that, not just over the past year, but I'd say for just seeing how peers are self-organising over the last sort of 18 to 15 months. And I do think, this is a personal view, that for sort of change to take place, it needs to happen on a number of levels, like you've spoken about. I think governance is absolutely key. Who's sitting on these boards, who's sitting on kind of funding boards as well. But also there needs to be sort of diverse approaches which aren't necessarily linked to arts organisations or sort of ACE-funded organisations. And I just wondered, from both of your kind of peer networks and projects that you've seen, where have you seen that sort of being enacted really well from your own areas of interest? Who are you seeing who are having interesting conversations? May they be peers or networks? And it could even be the participants that you've worked with.
Thanks, Amanprit. Shall I? Yeah, well, I really like the kind of language of flexibility sort of prompt that we should definitely develop. Well, I think also online there has, I really liked as well Roseanna say, we should, you know, we are taking our own space, we're building our own space. And I think this is happening as well online. Then if the online is public or not, I mean, we can get through lots of discussion here and I argue it's definitely not. But equally, we've seen, especially recently, not necessarily in that domain, but, you know, what happened on Reddit for the Wall Street Bet, to basically a self-organization of people online literally crash the stock market for a couple of days. That's an example of how really through technology as well, you can coordinate and cooperate. So in these regards, I'm as well particularly looking at the kind of networks creation, and in this line, the work of Fatherfield, which is a kind of a decentralized gallery space in Finsbury Park, is really working towards as well developing this sort of network dynamics in using kind of feminist economies and cooperatives and principle of permaculture. So again, working really beyond the institutionalized spaces to build our own spaces, wherein the governance is much more shared, the voting processes are less polarized or hierarchical, and it's lots of exciting work on that front.
And Roseanna, is there anything that you'd like to add, or anyone that you're sort of looking at, or you know, models or systems that you're thinking about?
Yeah, I guess we, you know, at Rising, we work with just honestly the most incredible bunch of like talented creatives. Everyone's under 30. They're all creating the change that they want to see. So a lot of the work is creative, but it's also got that kind of social change aspect to it. And you know, just thinking about our Be It program and the cohort of 10 young people we've worked with in 2020, and the next 10 people that we're going to be working with in 2021. The projects that they have been involved in and that they're going on to kind of work on this year, all speak to the need to build spaces for our communities to do the work and practice on our terms. And I would just encourage everyone to be honest, to look at the rising.org.uk website, and search for Be It, and you'll see kind of profiles of all of the young people. I mean, there's multidisciplinary directors through to kind of people working more in sound and audio, and making some really interesting interventions there. We're releasing kind of the commissions that they've been working on, and some of that is centering very much around like processes of care, of how we slow down, and you can really start to see the importance of exploring this stuff as a cohort and those spaces to bring your individual practice but also kind of link up. And I'm really excited for what they're all going to kind of continue to work on, so I would encourage people to have a look at them. There's some really interesting models and things that they're testing out.
Really exciting. And you know, and that type of sharing doesn't really happen enough in the sector. Where do we get to do that? So those are conversations I'm really interested in. There was a really lovely comment which said that these conversations feel heart-centered, and I'm really interested, and I've used at the moment I'm working as one of the artistic directors with Jade Montserrat on Syllabus, which is an alternative education program, and I started that conversation with that amazing group of artists through talking about bell hooks, kind of language of love. And I just wondered, and language has come up quite a bit in the chat thread, and the importance of it. And I just wondered from your experiences, what it kind of means for the language around these conversations to shift for both the participants and the sector as well. And what it means to, and what does it mean for each of you to have like heart-centered conversations? And we're not talking about sort of woolly, hippie, although I'm also really interested in that. But what that might kind of afford, and what is it about language that has kept us in the same space when we're talking about ideas around agency and inclusion and diversity, and I'd say stuck in a particular place. And I just wondered what each of you thought around sort of that subject of language.
Well, on my side, and I mean, the project I presented as well is very much looking at that. I think language is crucial in the way in which society is run, in the sense that we all have to comply to use a certain language, from, you know, as well, merely kind of funding application to then evaluation processes. And we almost have always to align to a certain language that often belongs to markets and industry, but we're not really putting values on our own narratives and our own language in the way that sometimes, you know, stresses very much on practices of care, of attention. It is often considered as, you know, sort of like poetic or something that it's not really proper to more kind of official discourses. So I think there should really be, it's much needed, this shift of language towards really being more welcoming of as well non-verbal, less intelligible and much more experiential ways of dealing with things without always being subjugated into then writing forms, writing reports, which kind of match this sort of metric power. And talking about heart-centered conversation, I mean, it's definitely as well the drive of what we do and what we believe in and that we try to put in our practice. And this as well about really being willing to listen and kind of as well exchange dynamics of kind of hierarchies and really be present in everything we do. To me, that's the most important thing, really be present. Rather than getting sort of lost. It was clear.
It was. Roseanna, have you got anything that you want to add to that?
I think just to pick up on this point about listening and actually how listening and reflecting when you're really doing that as part of your processes, there's the opportunity for vulnerability. And actually, I think that's kind of at the heart of what institutions in particular need to think about and to really reassess what they're doing and how the language is used. And I can see in the chat, someone's written about, you know, the language of inclusion, and absolutely absolutely kind of assumes a cultural epicenter model, and this idea that the institution has agency. And I guess from what I see, I'm interested in platforming a completely different set of languages that's always changing and developing, in which we will resist being co-opted, which it will happen. But there is a resistance in that, in forming new language that works for you. Yeah.
Thank you. I know we're up to 10 past, which means we've run out of time, but I do want to acknowledge the conversation is really lively, and I think there's some important things to state around conversations like this. You know, sometimes we might spend an hour and a half together and realise that the question was the problem all along. You know, we don't have opportunities to think together. There's also a question around the fact that we're all in places of privilege to be sitting here. So actually, if we're not involving anyone who's excluded, well, what is it that's taking place here? And I do think it's a question of ethics, because I think, as far as I understood, the talk was about bringing professionals together, and whatever that means, and talking about our experiences within the sector. But it's an important thing to note. But I think whenever you bring non-professionals into a talk like this, which is an art world talk, there is, for me personally, a question around ethics. Why would they be interested in engaging in this? And we are all invested at varying degrees in the sector, in the art sector. Yeah, I mean, it would be great somehow to capture some of these conversations and, you know, see if, yeah, there's always too much, but some nice kind of will be in contact. I think everyone, you know, from what you've seen and heard, this is very much, you know, just a kind of taster in terms of what type of conversations that a question and a talk like this kind of prompts. The work's not easy, it's long term. I mean, there were kind of things around strategies, around slowness, around embedded engaged practice. This work is kind of hard when you work when you're thinking about these subjects, and it's a lifetime's worth of work, and you either make a commitment as an arts professional in that way or not. And I'm going to end it there. That sounds like quite a grandiose statement, but it's about sort of commitments and, you know, networking with people who have shared commitments within the sector. I think that's quite key if we're going to answer some of these questions. But a big thank you, Linda and Roseanna. It's been really nice for me because I'm learning about your practice for the first time. So a big thank you, and a big thank you to Up Projects. And I'll hand over to Emma now.
Thank you so much, Amanpreet and Linda and Roseanna. It's been such a hugely valuable and vital discussion. And, you know, as you've just articulated, Amanpreet, there's so much for the sector to learn and keep thinking about. And I think if we are going to make a shift in the way that we work, one of the best ways to do it one of the best ways to learn is to keep talking and keep sharing new ways of thinking and doing things. So hopefully, you know, this is just the very beginning of many more conversations. And thank you so much to our audience as well for participating and for all the comments and questions that you've shared in the chats, and we'll try and capture as much of that as we can. This is the first event in the Assembly series, and we really want to be able to listen and build on your feedback as well for future events. So as Amanpreet kindly said earlier, we particularly noted the comments in relation to access, how important it is to include signing and captions. We'll work on this for the next event. And please do share any further feedback with us. We would really love to hear it and build on it. And to that end, you'll see there's a questionnaire in the Slido bar, which we'd really love you to fill out before you leave, if you've got the time. And very much hope we will see you at the next Assembly event, which will be exploring what is collaboration. And that event will be looking to unpick some of those sort of nutty questions around the ethics of collaboration and co-creation, working with communities. And that event will be chaired by Matteo Lucetti, the curator at Visible Projects. We'll be announcing the full lineup of speakers through our social media channels in a couple of weeks' time. So do sign up to those if you haven't already. And also, as I said at the beginning, we'll be sharing case studies about the two projects that Roseanna and Linda talked about today. So please do look out for those on our website. And if you'd like to watch the film that Roseanna shared Under My Skin, I think there's a link there that you can link to see the full video. It's really worth taking a look at that too. We're going to be uploading a recording of today's event onto our YouTube channel, so that you'll be able to link to that from our website as well. And if you'd like to hear more about what we're doing in collaboration with Public Art Network, more information about the Assembly programme, please do join our mailing list and we'll keep you posted on that. So I think we're out of time. So thank you again to our amazing speakers. Thank you to the Art Fund for supporting this programme and to Public Art Network for inviting us to collaborate with them, and particularly to Jess Fernie, Teresa Byrne from Public Art Network and Elizabeth Del Pret, Art Projects Curator of Learning and Live Research, for putting together such a great programme. So yeah, let's keep talking and I look forward to seeing you at the next one. Thanks so much.